today I'll be doing the psychology paper part 2 analysis of paper 1. Hello everyone, today I'll be doing the psychology paper part 2 analysis of paper 1. So I did part 1 before and now I'll be continuing with part 2. So this is the 5th A question. The question says that should the researchers always formulate a hypothesis before collecting data? Justify your answer with appropriate example. Now the question is that should the hypothesis be formulated before collecting the data? Now they are asking you whether you agree with it or not. So what you can say is that if the hypothesis is formulated before collecting data, what are the issues? And you should also, you know, answer the question with respect to whether the hypothesis formulated after the collecting data, what would be the difference between it? So how you'll go about it, that you should mention about the complexities that would arrive when the researcher is formulating a hypothesis before collecting data. For example, there would be lack of awareness. Lack of content, or you can say lack of specific knowledge regarding the content, etc. Now, if you want, what you can do is, here you can write the theory of Daniel Goleman. You can also write the theory of social analysis. That means, see, what happens is when you are having the data with you, you will get a backing. So if data is not there, your backing will get weakened. So for that matter, these things will help you out. Okay, so this is how you can justify your justify your answer with respect to the theories that you have, and they are asking you for appropriate examples. So what you can do is you can find an example. For example, you can give an example of present day scenario, that is how children's behavior is getting affected by the use of video games. So the aggressive attitude. Now for this, you are going to formulate a hypothesis and you need to have a strong backing of data. You just can't go for a mental shortcut that the aggressive behavior in the children's, or the, for that matter, in the students, are because of this and this reason. For that you require data or in order to formulate a hypothesis. Okay. Now the next question is, discuss recent trends in the field of decision making. Now this question is very vast and the answer is also expecting you to cover multiple dimensions. And what will be that? See, decision making ability or decision making thing depend upon multiple factors. For example, it depends upon your emotional intelligence. It depends upon how you are witnessing crisis. Some people are very optimistic. So, that depends upon your psychic character. So, optimism. Now, the next thing that you can talk about is, for example, when COVID-19 was there. So, what was coming is how you are going to, address the crisis issue. So, the crisis management. Here you can give the present example of COVID-19. Then you can also refer to social behaviorism theory. That means it depends upon person to person how they are reacting to a situation, because certain people have a very calm attitude, certain people are very aggressive. So the decision making ability is quite a lot dependent upon the behavior of the person. So you can't expect the similar behavior from the person who is having this very aggressive attitude and the person who is very calm with the situation. So the one who is very calm with the situation will have a very different way of dealing the situation. So the decisions that person is going to make will be extremely different with the person who is aggressive. So social behaviorism is again playing a big role over here. You can also write about how present day digital media is affecting decision making. Digital media has a very large influence. And the large influence means what? For example, when it comes to making, or you know, when it comes to analyzing a situation, so how digital media plays a big role, because now people are exploring new different avenues. So these avenues are probably coming from this digital media also, because people are talking about various perspectives and opinions. So these opinions can be easily checked over here, digital media. Fine. The next question says that how does gender differences account for behavior? Again, these questions require a very deeper understanding. And what is that? That how does gender differences account for behavior? Now, gender, that means if you go with the scenario of present day context, for example, if you are going to consider the LGBTQ community, then your answer will be totally different. And if you are going based on the two sexes, that is male and female, or you can say man and women. So what you are going to do here is, see, again, what you can tell about or how you can answer this question is that when it comes to men, if you are referring to this as gender specific, so they are having more of a ability of bread earning. Fine. So it is considered from them to be very strong, you know, and masculine. So this is accounting for an aggressive behavior. Now, when it comes to women, here it is expected that they are quite, feminine characteristics. So, they have the ability of nurturing. More tenderness. Fine. So this is how you have to, you know, understand the question. Now, based on this, what you are going to write about is, see, you can write about the concepts of socialization. That means the way men socialize is extremely different the way women are socializing. So that also acts as a part of what behavior. Other than that, what you can do is you can also segregate based on biological factors that I told you just now. In some scenarios, what you can do is you can go with the mental well-being. Now, your psychologists are not going to change. For example, paper 1, you are having those defined psychologist. So, what you are going to do is, depending upon your mental health and characteristics. So this also, you know, changes from person to person. For example, the mental health or the mental condition of the men's vary from the women. So here you can give this significance also. You can also talk about intersectionality. Fine. Now, let's move on to the next question. What hypothetical ideas lead to the development of projective personality test? So, the question is asking you what hypothetical ideas lead to the development of projective personality test. So, what are those hypothetical ideas that are or that will help in the development of projective personality test? So for that, you should know about what is a projective personality. That is now, in on the basis of projective personality, what you can talk about is the reflection of person's behavior. And this could be unconscious behavior, the reflection of person's thought on person's personality. Other than that, you can also talk about the conditioning of the person. Now, what you can do here is that what are those hypothetical ideas that are leading to the development of the person's personality? So, what you can write here is about the psychoanalytic test. You can briefly explain the psychoanalytic test by Freud. That will help in knowing the person's personality. Yeah, this will be one such. What hypothetical ideas led to the development of? Yes, so this is one of your hypothetical idea. So psychoanalytic test. Other than that, you can write about personality assessment also. Yeah. Now, when it comes to personality assessment, what is happening is that you are going to talk about whenever you are meeting anyone, whenever you are coming in contact with a person, what is happening is that you try to perceive them, you try to imitate them. So what happens is that here you are assessing the person's personality. How? Assessing person's personality through perceiving. Fine. Then you can also write about, or you can also talk about Carl Jung's theory. So you can write about Carl Jung's theory. Fine. So this is how you are going to address this question. Next is knowledge without use is useless. Discuss the statement focusing on the application of psychology in resolving societal problems. Now, if you see, the question is demanding you first to know that the knowledge without use, that means the knowledge you people are having for that matter, and you are not using it. So it becomes useless. So based on this saying, what they are demanding is that discuss the statement focusing on application of psychology in resolving societal problems. So firstly, you should know about the societal problems, and based on those problems, what you are going to do is that you are going to talk how you are going to resolve these problems. How you are going to resolve these problems, focusing on the application or the part through psychology, because this could be answered from many other aspects, but since they are focusing on psychology, so you have to address it through psychology. So what you need to do is here, see, you can talk about mental health psychology. So mental health psychology, see, if the person is very appropriate in his or her stand, so they are able to resolve the societal problems, because they'll find the middle ground, right? So based on that mental health psychology, then you can talk about, crisis intervention, for example. See, more or less this part has been, very analytical based. Why? Because if you are able to analyze the situations, or if you are able to relate it well, probably the solutions would be fair enough. So if crises are there, they are interfering. So what is going to happen is that you are able to take this crisis, and how you are able to resolve that doubt, that is also, a part of psychology. So some people get very doomed and they're not able to take it well. So here you will talk about crisis intervention psychology. And what is that? That means you are going to talk about a crisis might happen to take a fallout on you, or at the same time might build you. So if this is the thing, you are going to resolve the issues. And this won't affect it. Fine. Other than that, you can talk about policy advocacy. There are multiple things that you can write here. And see, keep relating this with respect to the psychologist. For example, if you are, for example, I have been talking about Albert Bandura, you are talking about Daniel Goleman, I have talking about Martin, I have talked about Shishal theory. So, just start linking with it. Probably then you'll sail through this paper. Okay. Now the next question is that in view of Piaget, intellectual development takes place through stages which occur in a fixed order, okay, and which are universal regardless of social and cultural background. So critically examine Piaget's point of view in detail. Now, what is happening is that Piaget believes that the intellectual development process happens through multiple stages. For all those who have read it and have written the paper, so they are aware of it. And for all those who are not, Piaget was of the opinion that since we have this childhood phase, then we have this teenage and then adulthood, etc. So what is happening is that based on those stages, there is intellectual development at different stages. So this is what Jean Piaget has talked about. So there were such phases which are, for example, sensorimeter, then there is concrete operational stage, etc. So what you can do is, first you need to define all those phases of stages of development. And what are those stages of development? Based upon right from the birth to the adulthood. So all those stages of development you have to write over here. You have to give a brief overview. Now, which occur in a fixed order, which are universal regardless of social and cultural background. That means Piaget was very confined to the intellectual process. Is solely dependent on who these stages of development. Fine. Now, what is happening is they are saying that, now Piaget said that this is all what it is. And this is universal. Fine. Now, other psychologists have critically, examined this, and they were of the opinion that there's a lot many factors that plays in the intellectual development of a person. So, even if you go with the layman's term, what is happening is that a person's experience help in intellectual development. Again, other than that, the various psychologists have talked about what. They have said that culture play a big role. And what is that? For example, you can write about Gotsky's theory. Now, Gotsky has focused on culture aspect. Then you can write about Brunner. Brunner, Gotsky. You can write about Triandis. So, Triandis is also acting as one of the important part. The psychologist is also talking about culture acting as one of the very important part in the intellectual development of a person. So, you can talk about all of them. You can also talk about David Auspel. Now, David Auspel said that education David Auspel was of the opinion that apart from culture, education also plays a big role in intellectual development. Fine. So, this is how Piaget's theory was critically examined. Now, let's move on to the next one. Discuss formation of stereotypes and prejudices with the help of suitable examples. Now, what you can do over here is, first you need to, differentiate. You need to introduce stereotypes. You need to understand what is prejudices. And then what you can do is, they are saying discuss. Yeah. So how is, stereotypes formed? How are prejudices are formed? And this should be done with the help of suitable examples. Fine. So, this could be, done through, for example, if you are discussing about stereotypes, you should write about social learning. So, this is a social learning theory. That means whatever learnings you are having, for example, you can talk about your the way you are observing and socializing. So, for example, say people of certain religion, you know, socialize together. So they have very less acceptance to the other religions. So here you talk about the process of socialization. You can talk about observation. Fine. So this is about stereotypes. Other than that, you can focus on cognitive processes also for stereotypes. And here you can write about Alport. Now, what was you know, this person's opinion? For example, the person said that a lot of things depends upon how the person is perceiving things, perceiving, analyzing, etc. When it comes to prejudices, what is happening is, in prejudices, we tend to formulate things in our mind, and based on that we act. For example, we negate something, and that negation becomes, you know, very constant in our mind and very harsh, or you can say very hard on us. So based on that, you can talk about prejudices. Now, what you can write in prejudices, that is, you can talk about social identity theory. Now, there is social identity theory. Then you can talk about, then you can talk about the realistic theories. Both these theories could be mentioned in prejudices. Why? Social identity theory is doing what? Now, in social identity theory, for example, if you see whenever the cricket matches are going on, what is happening? You know, people tend to become, you know, very strong in their opinions, and some or other times it is overflow of emotions. So what is happening is then this becomes a part of prejudices. So your identity kind of thing becomes so so strong in your mind that sometime or other humanity takes a back seat. So that is what you can talk about. Then you can talk about realistic theory. Here you can realistic conflict theory. Realistic conflict theory. So what is realistic conflict theory? Based on realistic conflict theory, you can write about, see, what happens is in the process, and there's a lot of competition. So you know the realistic world. Based on these things, you formulate you have your judices. Fine. So now the self social identity theory was given by John Turner, and this realistic conflict theory is given by Morton Dutch. So you can talk about Turner, then you can talk about Morton Dutch. Fine. The next question is, explain how a double blind experiment is used to overcome the experimental bias and participant expectancy effects. Fine. See, what is double blind experiment? Now, when there is a double blind experiment, double blind means that your experimenter is also unaware and your participant is also unaware. So both your parties are unaware. So for that you need to explain this double blind theory, double blind experiment. Yeah. and then you need to explain how this will be able to, you know, give an effective result, and this result will be not a result that was expected. Fine. So what you can write about here is, see, you can talk about a lot many factors. For example, the critical information is, critical information is not on notice. Other than that, what you can talk about here is Fort's theory. You can also write about D. Holland. Here you can answer this question with respect to multiple case studies. So you can talk about the study of Holland. Fine. Other than that, you can also, you can write about Holland. You can also talk about the theory that was given by Ford, Rosenthal and Ford. So the case studies of Rosenthal. Okay. Then the next one is, how do intelligence and aptitude differ? So first you need to know about the difference between intelligence and aptitude. Then explain the two in the light of G and S factors of intelligence, giving suitable example. Now see what is happening is, how do intelligence and aptitude differ? See, intelligence is something which you can refer as IQ based. That means you have an ability to perceive things. You have the ability to solve a, you know, solve a question. You have the ability to interpret it. You have the ability to answer it based on your intellectual capacity, your capacity build, capacity of your mind. Now, when it comes to aptitude, that means you have an intense ability to learn something, or you can say you have an interest on a particular field, for that matter. For I would say that means you have this keen interest on certain thing, and then what you are doing is you are constantly trying to learn it, constantly trying to perceive it, constantly trying to understand it, and based on your aptitude you are able to do so. For example, who should I refer to? For example, the very famous cricketer Sachin Tendulkar has a very good aptitude for cricket, right? Then what you can do here is, you can't say that he could become the famous lawyer, or you know, he might, but right now, seeing his career graph, what we can say is he has a great aptitude for cricket. So that is what aptitude is, and this is what intelligence is. Now they are saying that explain the two in the light of G and S factor. So what are your G and S factor? So G factor was given by Spearman, and G factor was G factor was given by Spearman, and that is your mental ability. That is your intelligence. Fine. Now, when it comes to S factor, what is your S factor? Now, see, in G factor, just give a detailed description about the Spearman's theory. For example, you can talk about how the mental capacities help you to, you know, the or it expands the ability to understand, learn, etc. So everything you can learn, understand. Etc. Fine. Now when it comes to S factor, that is your aptitude factor. So what you can talk about here is Riemann Kettle's theory. Or Riemann Kettle's theory, the S factor. That means you are having what? A constant intelligence with what to learn something. You have the ability, or you have the, you know, keen interest to enhance your skills. So this is enhance your skills. So this is your G factor and S factor of intelligence. Riemann Kettle's G factor for Spearman and S factor for Riemann Kettle. Fine. Now let's move on to the next question. What is the meaning and significance of plasticity of perception? So what do you understand by this? And what is plasticity of perception? Now, in the plasticity of perception, first you need to define this. Plasticity of perception is that your ability to change the thinking of your mind. That means, for example, you are behaving in a certain pattern. You are, and it's not about only you. It's about everyone. So what is happening is that you have the ability to solve a problem in a certain way. You have this got certain behavior. Or, certain way to analyze a thing. So, what is happening is, here you are changing it. And changing it, that means you are changing your methods, your perception, your ability to think. So, this is referred as plasticity of perception. That means you are perceiving things now in a different way. For example, sometime or other you had this way of perceiving things through a negative way, and now what is that? Whatever good bad is happening to you, you are perceiving it in a way that, okay, fine, let's see how it goes about. So that becomes what? Plasticity of perception. So this is the meaning. Now what is its significance? So here you can write about theories of you can mention about Jean Piaget's theory. Just now we have done that intellectual development theory. So intellectual development theory, that you can talk about Jean Piaget. Then what you can do is after this you can talk about Jean Piaget, yes, then you can talk about development stage also. That means every stage of development, based on your social and cultural characters, what is happening is that you are perceiving things, differently. So your development is happening in 360 degree orientation. Fine. So you can talk about the development stage. You can talk about Jean Piaget. Other than that, you can also write about one very important, that is Kandel's learning and memorizing concepts or theories. Learning and memorizing. Now, this is a method of Kandel. That means based on this, you have the ability of learning and memorizing things in a different manner. Fine. Now, You can talk about many of things other than this also, but if you are giving a detailed description about this, I think this is your question 7B. Yeah, 7B. So, yes, you can give a detailed explanation for this. Okay. Next one is, what are the steps for effective communication training? Discuss in detail. So, what you can do here is, you can talk about, effective communication training. So, what are the steps for that? Effective communication is what? Where the individuals have the ability to, you know, understand. So, that is what effective communication. If understanding is missing, then the communication is not effective. If there is anything that is coming out to be positive, so that act as a part of effective communication training. So, what you can do here is, you can write about multiple factors. For example, you can, here you can give the theory of, Albert Bandura. And Albert Bandura, with respect to what? Self-efficacy theory. So you can, describe this. That means if you are having a good communication training, so what is happening is that you are working towards your self-development. Yeah. So self-efficacy theory. Then you have what? You set clear objectives. You have, good communication model. So what happens is you have clear objectives. That means you have defined set of goals. Objectives. Goals, yeah. Now, other than that, what you can talk about is B.F. Skinner's skill development theory. That means this also helps you in development of skills. So, Albert Bandura, B.F. Skinner, you can talk about Kenneth Thomas. That means you have gained the ability of Kenneth Thomas. You have the ability of what? You get the ability to negotiate. Negotiation skills, etc. The next question is, do childhood experiences affect us in our entire lives? Elaborate your answer in the light of personality theories. Now, here what you can do is that first you can talk about a few psychoanalytic theory. Now, based on this Freud psychoanalytic theory, what you are going to talk about is that how experiences shape your personality. Fine. So, one theory is your Sigmund Freud psychoanalytic theory. You can also talk about attachment theory of Bowlby. Then, you can talk about social learning theories that I have just done with you. Now, the next question is, how can the memory be improved with the help of organization and mnemonic techniques? Now, here what you can write about is the ability of the memory to, to restore. A lot of chunk data. Fine. So the question is all about that, how your memory gets, how can the memory be improved with the help of organization and mnemonic techniques. So here you can write about the method of loci, or you can also talk about memory placing technique, etc. So you can memory placing technique. Now in this technique, see, you can highlight about multiple techniques. So what you can do is that here you are going to talk about the relevance of the mnemonics in trying to grasp things. So this is just one technique that I've talked about. Here are multiple techniques. For example, you can talk about spaced repetitions, you can talk about rhymes, you can also talk about acronyms. So you can talk about acronyms, you can talk about rhymes, etc. So everything will be covered in this one. The last question was, human behavior is affected by multiple factors that tend to overlap, as a result of which it is difficult to analyze the cause of behavior. That means you are going to talk about multiple factors that are governing the human behavior, as a result of which it is difficult to analyze the cause of behavior. That means you are not able to able to find the main cause of the behavior. For example, again, see, you can write. See, you go with Albert Bandura's theory, explain it. Then you can go with B.F. Skinner's theory. Fine. Then you can talk about Freud's theory of psychoanalysis. Fine. Albert Bandura talked about social learning theory. So write about social learning theory here, write about behaviorism. Freud may write about psychoanalysis. If you want, then write about Daniel Goleman. There are multiple things. Like all around the paper, there are so many psychologists we have covered. You can refer to all of them, because somewhere or other everyone is going to influence your behavior. Okay, so this one, with this, your paper one is done. I'll be soon coming with the paper two analysis. Thank you so much.